Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So we want to welcome everyone to the ISKCON festival and the glorification of Lord Balarama. Tomorrow is Balarama Jayanti, one of the most auspicious and holy days of the year. It's the appearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Balarama. So we'll go right into the lecture. Om Agyan Timiran Dasya Vinarajana Salakaya Chakshu Unyavitam Yena Asya Shri Gurudeva Shri Chaitanya Vrabhavishyam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantitam Ande Am Shri Guru Shri Vrabhavadamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sagranamakanatam Ditam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Param Sagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinamandu Chirapate
Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Katakanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamani Hari Priye Mancha Kalpana Rubyasya Kripa Sindhu Vyayasya Adhinana Bhavane Vyo Vaishnave Vyo Namo Namah Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadhara Srivatsadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Weeks before we honor the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Shri Krishna's appearance, we also honor his immediate expansion, Sri Balaramji, who is no different than Krishna. The only difference between Lord Balaram and Lord Krishna, as is mentioned in the Chaitanya Charitamrita and other places, is that Krishna's transcendental color is like a blackish rain cloud, and Balaram's color is like a beautiful white spring cloud. That's the only difference between these two personalities. And they appeared more than 5,000 years ago to perform their leelas. When the Supreme Personality of God comes to this world, he does three things. Or he tries to enact three aspects of his own desires. One is personal, two is, the other two are for the upliftment of the world in general. Yada yada hi dharmasya glamir bhavati bharata mabhutanam sadharmasya tadatmaham srijamiyam pravitranaya sarunam vinashtanaya jaduskritam dharma samstar padarthaya Sambhavami Yuge Yuge. So Krishna in the fourth chapter of Srimad Bhagavad Gita explains that he comes for three reasons. When irreligious principles become strong in the world and overshadow piety and religious principles, and when there is an increase of the demoniac population, he comes for Vitranayam Salunam Panasana Padusku. Dharma samstapanartya, yuge yuge, millennium after millennium, he comes. But the Lord does not have to perform an appearance in order to accomplish the upliftment of religious principles or the removal of demons. Why does he come? To give pleasure to his devotees. So that is the actual appearance reason for the Lord to give pleasure to his devotees. Those who are trying to serve him in this material world, he comes just to give them his association and to invite them to take greater and greater, what we say, strides towards perfection in spiritual life. The Lord is very merciful. And so, Lord Balarama and Lord Krishna are, we might say, different than that. The nature of the absolute truth is not like some calculation that you can logically explain. Something can be different and non-different at the same time and be correct. In this world, when something is different and non-different, it's either one or the other. It's either different or non-different. But the absolute truth can, when we say, amalgamate all opposites and still be absolute in its performance. So Krishna and Balarama are the same and different. They are this one Supreme Personality of Godhead. And I would like to read a few of the beautiful names that are associated with Lord Balarama. There's one beautiful scripture written by one great sage called Candramauli. And the scripture is called Darga Samhita. And in that, he spends one particular section glorifying the beautiful names of Lord Balarama. To hear the glories of the Lord, to be eager to hear the glories of the Lord, brings one closer and closer to perfection in spiritual life. That eagerness helps us to understand deeper what is the actual nature of the Lord. Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita, nobody can understand me. He says, nobody. He says, I know everything in the past, I know everything that is happening in the present, and I know all events that will come in the future. I also know all living entities, because he's situated in everyone's heart. But then he concludes by saying, me, God, is practically impossible. But we can know God to the level of perfection. In other words, we can know enough about God to reach our own spiritual, full spiritual consciousness. And so Krishna comes to perform his pastimes, to invite us. And some of the things that he performs while that is that he is decorated with all transcendental qualities. So some of these names really describe his transcendental appearance and his qualities and characteristics. So I'll read just a few of them so we can get a little idea about Lord Balarama. Actually, in one scripture, it mentions that there's 1,000 names of Balarama. 1,000 names. So here's just a few of them. And Candramauli starts, I glorify Lord Balarama, decorated with glittering crown, bracelets. So turn a picture of this in your mind. Put a picture of Lord Balarama in your mind. So if you've been to Vrindavan, you see the little beautiful Krishna Balarama. Or if you've been to any temple in ISKCON, which has Krishna Balarama deities, or if you've seen a picture of Krishna Balarama, put Balarama in your mind. He's beautiful. He's so white that he defies whiteness. A white lotus becomes embarrassed in front of Balarama because his whiteness makes the lotus look very unwhite. So just picture Lord Balarama, and I'll describe some of his transcendental decorations. He's decorated with a glittering crown, bracelets, tinkling ornaments, moving locks of hair on his cheek. So he has these curly locks that come, and when he moves, the locks also move. Splendid earrings on his handsome lotus face. Now, the word lotus is used a lot in describing something beautiful. But it can't really fully describe the beauty of the absolute truth. Because when you try to use an analogy of something in this world to describe the absolute truth, which is beyond everything in this world, it's simply an analogy, that's all. it can't really give the full understanding of what we're trying to describe. But we make an effort, so we get a little idea, that's all. So a lotus is very beautiful. Have you ever seen a lotus flower? It's so beautiful. Is it the way it's it contours with the petals and it so shapes so nicely? And when you hold it, you think, I'm not going to give it to anybody. It's so nice. So that is considered one of the most outstanding, beautiful elements of the creation of the Lord. And so it's used as an analogy to help us get a little understanding of the beauty of the Lord. Because what do devotees find very attractive of the Lord? His beauty. Two things that the devotees really like about the Lord is his compassion and his beauty. These two things. Sometimes people like God because he's rich. You know, that's okay. But really, his transcendental beauty captures the mind, the eyes, the heart, and absorbs one in a meditation that seems to make everything in this world look pale. I was just looking at the beautiful form of Lord Balarama when he first entered the temple a couple hours ago. I was thinking, whoa, that's nice. I'm getting a little tiny drop of something that is way beyond my understanding. Because if you could actually see fully, which it takes transcendental eyes, Premanjarita Bhakti Vilochanina Santasa Daiva Vidayeshu Virokayoti Yamshama Sundara Chintya Guna Sarupa Govinda Adi Purusham Tamaham Vajami. It says when your eyes are decorated with love, the eyes are beautiful, but when it has the ointment of love over the eyes become the most beautiful. And those eyes, when they're used to see the beautiful form of the Lord, become mesmerized by that form, become absorbed in that form. So the Lord is, sometimes we say the Lord is beautiful, but that's not really correct. We say the Lord is beauty. He is beauty. So whatever is beautiful is coming from that source. He's the source of everything wonderful. So whatever is beautiful in this world is a fraction or a drop of that full beauty that's coming from the source, Lord Balarama, Lord Krishna. So, continue with your meditation. Splendid earrings on his handsome lotus face, and garments dark like monsoon clouds. He wears dark blue colors. He likes blue. How many of you like blue? Yeah, blue's a nice color. I don't want to sound toot my own horn, but when I was a kid, the first car I ever got was a blue car. I didn't know anything about God or what the color he was or who he was, or, you know. And I wanted a dark blue car. I got it. I had it specially made because they didn't have that color. I don't know why I like dark blue for some reason. That's another story. Anyway, dark blue, he's dark blue, not just blue, but that bluish color that is so deep in the color blue. And he holds a great club and a plow. He has two weapons. His club's name is Sunanda, and his plow's name is, yes, that's the plow. What is it? Balaram's plow's name, he has a name. I'm getting close. Haladar.
Haladara.
Dara means holder, and hala means plow. So he's the holder of the plow. So what do those two symbols mean? They're very important because the heart is like a garden. But sometimes there's weeds in the garden, and when the weeds are there, the flowers can't grow. So bringing Balaram into your heart, he's the supreme agriculturalist. And he's using his plow to plow through our heart and get rid of those weeds. And then when the ground is fertile, then the seed of bhakti can be planted nicely. If you plant a seed in an unfertile ground, Even if you order it, you get very little or practically nothing. So a seed has to be put in a fertile ground. So when bhakti, the seed of bhakti is planted in our heart by the spiritual master. Balaram is the original spiritual master, where all other spiritual masters come from. So when we honor Lord Balaram, we are honoring him as that spiritual master, which fertilizes and purifies our hearts, so the seed of bhakti can be planted nicely. And what is the watering process? Hearing and chanting the glories of the Lord. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
So when that's the watering onto the seed of bhakti, which makes the creeper of our love for God grow and grow and grow. When that creeper reaches all the way up to the spiritual world, then we have reached perfection. But it won't grow in an unfertile ground. There's where Balaram comes. That's why Balaram comes before Krishna, because he's preparing our hearts and minds for the appearance of Krishna, who is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is known as Servitor Godhead, and Krishna is known as the Supreme Godhead who is being served. So God is manifested in two aspects of himself, one who serves and one who is serving. So serving Godhead is Balaram. He is a Godhead. What does he do? He serves Krishna in different ways. And he serves us by teaching us the process of pure devotional service. He's the original spiritual master. He's called Adi Guru. That's another name for Balaram. And so Balaram, he likes to serve the Supreme Personality of God. He is God himself, but he's in the mood of serving God. And we'll speak about that in a few minutes. Okay, so he's holding a great club and a plow. So his club is for what?
Killing demons.
Killing demons, right? How many of you like when demons are killed? I know you're all non-violent, you know. And so you're just kind of like, but when God kills demons, hey, the demon gets the best possible thing that he can get, right? Because he gets rid of his demoniac mentality and he gets liberation. Because God is good, so when he's loving, he's good, and when he's killing, he's good. There's no difference between his activities in either aspect. Some people like the loving aspect and they go, oh, you know. And some people like the divine aspect too. But the divine aspect of ridding the demons from the world. Because demons block the path of spiritual life and cause difficulty to the devotees of the Lord. Therefore, Balaram comes. I remember when I was in New Vrindavan, that's when I first joined. If you look at the beautiful form of Lord Balaram, he has a symbol of a plow on his right hand and the symbol of the club on his left hand. So after some time, I left New Vrindavan and I went to Chicago to stay there. And I saw Lord Balaram and he had the symbol of the club on his right hand and the symbol of the plow on his left hand. It was reversed. So I'm thinking, which way is correct? So I had to ask the temple president. And I said, well, you know, I was in New Vrindavan, Balaram, he's got his plow on his hand and his club on his hand, and he's here in Chicago. He said, yes, there's more demons in Chicago. And yeah, he does more agriculture in New Vrindavan, which is a farm. So I thought that was quite interesting. So Balaram's always correct in whatever way he manifests himself. So he has these two weapons. and he fulfills all desires. He's as handsome like a mountain of ice and snow. Have you ever seen a beautiful mountain covered with ice and snow? Sometimes you think, wow, that is really attractive. Especially if you go to Switzerland. Have you ever been to Switzerland? Yeah, you see the mountains there? Sometimes during the summertime, there's ice and snow on the mountains because they're so high up. It stays snowy the whole year round. Lord Balarama is supremely powerful and happy. So one of his names is called Balabhadra. He's the supreme enjoyer. He's called Ramabhadra. All attractive, Sankarshan, infallible, Achyuta. The lover of Revati Raman, the splendid supreme personality Godhead, Deva, the Lord fulfills desires, Kamapala, and he who carries a plow weapon called Halayuda. He is dressed in blue garments, Nilambar, fair complexion, Swetavarna, splendid and powerful, Baladev, the elder brother of this infallible Supreme Personality of Godhead, Chintagraja, the killer of Palamba, Palamba Bhagna, a great hero, Mahavirya, the son of Rohini, Rauhineya, and very powerful, Pratipavan. He is intoxicated by drinking Varuni. He gets dropped on the table. Varuni Mada Matanga. His eyes roll with intoxication. Mada Gornita Lochana. His eyes are lotus flowers, Padmaksa. He wears a lotus garland, Padmamali, and a forest garland, Vanamali. Where's our Vanamali? Another name for Balarama. Where's a forest garland? Don't call him Balarama. And his fame is sweet, Madhurya Shrava. His eyes are glittering stars, Taraksa. His nose is graceful, like a parrot's beak, Kiranasa. His lips are bimba fruits, Bimbosta. His gentle smile is splendid and glorious, Su Smita Chaivi. His arms are elephant trunks, Karindra Kara Kodanga. He is ferocious, Prachanda. He is splendid like a host of monsoon clouds, Megamandala. His chest is like a great door, Kapata Vaksa. His shoulders are broad, Pinamsi. His feet are splendid like lotus flowers, Panda Panda, Spuraduti. He is very powerful and glorious, Mahaviduti. He is the master of all living entities, Bhutesa. He is the liberator from material bondage, Banda Mokshi. And he is the most wise and intelligent, Samikshana. His arms are like palm trees. And so it goes on and on and on. So this is some of the beautiful descriptions of the different qualities and ornamentations of Lord Balarama. He likes to dress. So those of you who are pujaris, make sure. And be careful. Now, I know this is a very confidential thing I'm about to reveal to you. So remember this. If you're serving Lord Jagannath, and Lord Jagannath is not getting the proper service, Balarama will let you know. He protects his elder brother. There's a story in one place it's called Rajpur. Have you been to Rajpur? Yes, in Navadvipa, Giram Temple. And they have Jagannath deities there. So Jagannath, Baladev, Subhadra Maharani. So when they first got the deities in 1979, they had no temple. So they had a little wooden frame that they used for a temple, and there was no doors on the temple. So one time, two boys, one Muslim, one Hindu, came to take darshan of the deities. So the Hindu boy said to his Muslim friend, "I'm going in to see the Lord. Would you like to come?" He said, "I don't believe in idols." So he waited outside. So the Hindu boy, he came back out, and he had some Mahaprasadam. And he said to his friend, "There is a little remnants of the deity's offering." He said, "I don't eat food from idols." So, okay, so his friend didn't, you know, push it. So that night, that Muslim boy went home, and in his dream, Baladev, Jagannath, and Subhadra appeared. And Baladev was grabbing him around the throat and strangling him in the dream and saying, "You don't want the food of my brother? You should die." And this was a real live dream. He was suffering in the dream. And so he's choking him. And Subhadra, Jagannath is laughing, and Subhadra is yelling, "Kill him! Kill him!" Well, she's Shakti, you know. You don't mess with Subhadra. And so he wakes up, the dream is over, his neck is completely red. This is a true story. So, you know, he's shaken up by the dream. He goes to the temple the next day, and he walks up to the pujari, and he said, "You have some of that food?" And the pujari said, "What happened to you?" And then he told the whole story. He said, "This white one," pointed to Balarama, "he was strangling me and saying, 'If you don't eat the food of my brother, you're going to die.'" And this yellow one was saying, "Kill him." And this black one was laughing. So, I mean, we have a different picture of God sometimes. But he wanted to give him a nice lesson. And then obviously he learned from that. And he appreciated the Lord in these beautiful forms. So Jagannath, if he's not served nicely, Balarama will let you know. One way or another, because he's the protector of Lord Jagannath. And he makes sure Jagannath is served nicely. So if we can please Lord Balarama, then we can please Lord Jagannath. So Balarama, he appears in every ras. And there is neutrality, which is called Shantaras. There is called Dashiras, which is servitorship. There is Sakyaras, which is fraternity. There is Madhuryaras, which is conjugal love. And there is Vatsalyaras, which is parental affection. Lord Balarama appears in all five rasas to serve Lord Krishna, just to show how he goes out of his way to serve Krishna, who is none different than himself. So the relationship is like that. Balarama is always trying to please Krishna, and Krishna is always trying to glorify Lord Balarama. So that's the relationship as two brothers. So in neutrality, this is very important for those of you who live in the temple. The mridanga is Balarama. It's not different than Balarama. You should never put the mridanga on the ground. You never use the mridanga other than for playing kirtan. Mridanga is an incarnation of Balarama. So Balarama comes as the paraphernalia of the Lord to assist the Lord in his pastimes in this world. The arti paraphernalia on the altar, that's Balarama. And when you do the arti, that paraphernalia, that's Balarama. The jewelry that the deity wears, not all of it, but much of it, is Balarama. The Lord's crown is Balarama. The Lord's bed is Balarama. The Lord's shoes is Balarama. The Lord's umbrella, and these are all incarnations of Lord Balarama. So we may think these are just paraphernalia of the Lord, but they're actually incarnations of Lord Balarama. He does that in order to serve the Lord in the neutrality rasa. In the dasya rasa, he serves as his friend. He serves as his, he's always doing different services to the Lord. In sakya rasa, he serves as his friend. He is Krishna's bigger brother, and he's always performing activities along with Krishna. So you see Balarama and Krishna always together in Vrindavan. In Vatsalya rasa, he's his older brother. When Krishna goes out to play in the cowherd fields, and he forgets to come home, Lord Balarama says, "Hey, your mother wants you to come home to eat." And so his mother, Mother Yasoda, tells Balarama, make sure he's protected and he comes home on time. So he's like a parent to Krishna in the mood of Vatsalya rasa, protecting the Lord. And then the Madhurya rasa, this is very intimate and very hard to understand. He is the younger sister of Srimati Radharani, known as Ananda Manjari. We don't have much information about that, but that is mentioned by the great sages in the scripture. He manifests as Ananda Manjari to serve the Lord in Madhurya rasa like that. So the Lord Balarama, he takes so many manifestations just to serve Krishna. The spiritual world and all the planets in the spiritual world are Balarama. When Krishna expands, his immediate expansion is Balarama. From Balarama comes the Chaturvyuha, Vasudeva, Sankarsana, Aniruddha, and Pradyumna. That Sankarsana is Balarama. When he expands again, he expands into all the Narayan manifestations of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When Narayan expands again, he comes into the second Chaturvyuha, Mahasankarsana, Aniruddha, Prajumna, Vasudeva, which are the four aspects of the Absolute Truth in the Vaikuntha world. And then that second Mahasankarsana expands into Mahavishnu. Mahavishnu is the source of creation. And from Mahavishnu, Garbhadakshai Vishnu expands, and from Garbhadakshai Vishnu comes Lord Brahma. And from Lord Brahma, he is empowered by Lord Mahavishnu to arrange for the next creation we have. So that all this is coming by the energy of Lord Balarama. So Balarama performs a lot of different aspects of himself in relationship to the spiritual world and into and also in this material world as the Adi Guru, the original spiritual master. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it says that all the manifestations of the spiritual masters who come in this world on behalf of the Lord are energies of either Srimati Radharani or Lord Balarama. That's in Chaitanya Charitamrita. But Lord Balarama is known as the original Guru. And one should see one's spiritual master as a manifestation of the energy of Lord Balarama. Because Lord Balarama also guides one in one's spiritual master, in one's spiritual progress. He is called Bala. Bala means strength. And Rama, one who gives transcendental pleasure by using spiritual strength like that. Mm. Prabhupada, he said to us one time, because you've been to Vrindavan, yes? You've seen Krishna Balaram there? Yeah? And you see how the deities posed? Yeah. So Lord Balaram is leaning on Lord Krishna. So Prabhupada asked us, oh, he has a picture. Okay, he wants to make sure we look at it. Okay, so there's Lord Balaram and Lord Krishna. So Balaram is leaning on Krishna. Now Balaram means one who has transcendental strength. So Prabhupada asked us the question, who is strength? stronger? Is it Balarama or is it Krishna? So, you know, when Srila Prabhupada asks you a question, you get serious. You know? So, the devotees, some said Krishna, some said Balarama. So, whom, how many of you say Balarama? How many of you say Krishna? Looks like three. Okay, those of you who say Krishna, you're right. But why? Tell me the answer.
Because Balaram has a lean on Krishna.
Because Balaram is leaning on Krishna and Krishna's holding him up. So that transcendental pose that manifests as a darshan for all of us is the Lord's way of just showing their friendship together. But Prabhupada used that as a way to help us understand deeper what is the nature of Krishna and Balarama. Tomorrow, we'll have two classes, one in the morning for Srimad Bhagavatam and one in the evening on the pastimes of Lord Krishna. Balarama. Tomorrow we'll speak about the appearance of Lord Balarama. And Sunday there'll be two more classes, so we'll do five classes all together. Tonight I'm just trying to give you a little introduction of the nature of Lord Balarama and our relationship with him, so we can go deeper into that relationship. Balarama killed two demons that are known as Palombasura and Dainukasura. Dainukasura was an ass. Sometimes we use that word in ordinary parlance. So he was a servant of Lord of Kamsa, and he ruled a particular area of Vrindavan called Talavana Forest. And in that forest there were these beautiful, beautiful tal trees, and the tal fruit is sweet, but no one could go in there. Now the cowherd boys, they wanted to taste that fruit from the Talavana forest, but it was guarded by Dainukasura, who was a big demon, and all his cohorts were also, you know, asses. Because, you know, asses hang around with other asses. Excuse my language, but So the cowherd boys came to Krishna and said, Krishna, these fruits are so sweet and so nice and we're so hungry, but it's guarded by this demon. We can't get them. Can you get it for us? So Krishna and Balarama wanted to please the cowherd boys, so they went into the forest. And then Balarama walked into the forest and he was shaking a few trees and gathering a few fruits and starts eating the fruit. So Dainuk, he's getting all upset. Who's coming into my forest? And he sees this person there. He's white in color, blue garments. He's thinking, who is this guy? So he gets angry and he runs full force and he kicks Balarama in the chest as hard as he could. So Balarama, you know, he's busy eating the fruit, so he doesn't want to bother with this guy. So he kind of just, he felt like a breeze hit him, so didn't even faze him. So this demon goes back and takes a full run, and this time he's going to do it again. And this time Balarama's thinking, you know, he's just disturbing my feast. I'm enjoying these fruit, and this guy is interfering with my prasad. You know, sometimes when you're eating prasad, somebody comes along, you think, hey, come on, man, I'm eating. So he tries to kick Balarama again, and so Balarama's eating the fruit with one hand, and he grabs the demon by the legs with the other hand, and he goes, and he throws him up in the tree. And while he was spinning around, you know, sometimes we spin around in kirtan, but he was really spinning. He lost his life. and then he went flying up in a tree, and when he hit the tree, and knocked one tree down, and that hit tree hit another tree, and all the fruits came down, and all the coward boys said, "Oh, we got the fruit." So they start gathering the fruit up, and then, you know, he was stuck in the tree, he was finished. And his friends, the other ass demons, they came charging at Balaram and Krishna, and Balaram's eating with one hand and just taking the demons with the other hand. And all the whole tree line was full of these different color asses. It's described like that in the Krishna book, and it said it was a panoramic scene, different color asses. It looked quite beautiful. Because anything the Lord touches becomes nice. It's not like it's just, you know, a nice killing program. It was actually quite nice. And so, and then all the coward boys said, "Jai Balaram, Jai Krishna," and they start having a fruit feast. Jai. So that's a. Now, Dainukasura represents a particular anartha that we may carry around. So each of these demons that Krishna killed represents a bad quality that the living entity may manifest. And the Dainukasura is an ass. So you know what an ass is. Works hard for nothing. He gets a job 9 to 5. No, I'm just kidding. He works hard. I'm sorry. Cut that out of the lecture. He works hard for what? You see an ass. What does he do? He carries the load of a washerman or a worker on his back, and the worker says, "Here, Mr. Ass, here is a carrot." And the cat donkey says, "Home, carrot." So the carrot's, he's moving closer to the carrot's moving. And that way the washerman's getting his load carried. Because, you know, he just keeps moving the carrot forward. The cat donkey's thinking, "One more step." But he never gets it. And the washerman gets his load carried, and the donkey, and sometimes he gives the carrot to the donkey, and sometimes he eats it himself. But the donkey's so foolish that there's all kinds of grass all around, but he's thinking it's there. So the ass-like mentality is simply working hard in order to sometime maintain the body like that. So that's what is called. Or collecting a lot of useless information. Like people read all kinds of books. They know everything, but they don't know anything. They don't know anything about God. They can say how many people are in China, but who cares? Not even the Chinese don't care. So, you know, people collect all kinds of information. What is it? Guinness Books of Records and this and that. Information, carrying big loads of knowledge, which is useless knowledge when it comes time to death, to die. Yet knowledge can't save you. It's just a big burden. So this burden of working hard to maintain the body and work and collecting a lot of useless material knowledge represents Dainukasura. So only the spiritual master's instructions, which is a manifestation of Lord Balaram's mercy coming through the spiritual master, when the disciple takes that knowledge and applies it, they can get free from these two, what we say, useless characteristics. Working hard for nothing, but working hard just to maintain the body. The problem is, the birds, they don't work. They get enough food. Every living entity is supplied food by the Lord. Only the human beings have to work for food. It was automatically supplied by the Lord for every living entity. Even the baby. Baby is born, as soon as the baby's born, the mother's breast has milk. Where is that? It's not there before. It comes automatically by the arrangement of the Lord. So the Lord is supplying for every living entity food. So if one serves the Lord, then one doesn't have to worry about where will I find my food. The Lord is providing everything. I remember I was giving a lecture in India, and I was at a temple I had never been before, and I was with one senior devotee. And so I told the whole donkey story at the temple that night. And the next day I was sitting chanting japa with my godbrother, and right outside where we were, there was a whole bunch of donkeys. They weren't there before. So this friend of mine said, "You see, last night you told the donkey stories and the donkeys came to congratulate me." So I was thinking, at least I pleased the donkeys anyway. So working hard for material gain is not necessary. The Lord provides for every living entity automatically. Prabhupada says the elephant eats 40 kgs a day. What does he do? 40 kgs, that's like 100 pounds of food. Still, the Lord is providing. The ant, the Prabhupada said, if you take a piece of sugar and put it on top of the Empire State Building, the ant will find it. In other words, they have such a sense for sweetness that if it's anywhere within range, they will find it. So the Lord is providing for all living entities automatically. So working hard just to maintain the body or collecting a lot of useless knowledge is dana-kasura. So that is destroyed by the mercy of the spiritual master. Any demons that Krishna kills, he destroys the anarthas directly. But you have to destroy your own anarthas by the mercy of Balaram coming through your spiritual master. So there's a unique difference between the demons that Krishna killed and the demons that Balaram killed. Because the demons that Balaram killed means those bad qualities that those demons represented, we have to destroy by our own efforts. But with the guidance and mercy of the spiritual master. With the spiritual master's guidance and mercy, we become strong. On the sword, he was another demon killed by Lord Balaram. What did he do? He disguised himself as a cowherd boy and snuck into Krishna's pastimes. The boys played two games. One was Balaram who was on one side, and Krishna was on the other side. And Balaram's team won. So the losing team had to carry the winning team on their back. And so Palambasura, who was Palamba, he took the form of the cowherd. He took the form of this cowherd boy, and he was on Krishna's side. So when Krishna's side lost, Balaram was carried by this demon called Palumba. And so he's carried toward Balaram. And Balaram said, "No, we won the battle, and this nice cowherd boy is carrying me." But then all of a sudden, this cowherd boy starts going far away from everything. And Balaram says, "Well, where are you going?" And then he realizes this is not a cowherd boy. And so Balaram, when he does that, demon reveals his form as a demon. You can see this in the Krishna book. It's a nice picture. So Lord Balaram goes and hits him on the head. Finished. And he falls down dead, dying on that. So what does Palambasura represent? He represents unauthorized attachment to the opposite sex. In other words, illicit sexual connections. So, therefore, Krishna doesn't destroy that quality within us if we have it. We have to do that ourselves. And we can do it by the mercy of Lord Balaram. So the devotees pray to Lord Balaram to rid themselves of this bad quality illicit connections with the opposite sex. That doesn't mean married life, that means illicit connections. So that is considered to be a stumbling block in the path of one's spiritual life. Okay, so we went a little bit over time, a few minutes, because I'm supposed to stop at 8:30. And tomorrow night will continue. And tomorrow is Balarama Jayanti, so please come and bring your friends. Tomorrow will be a grand celebration. Tomorrow is a fast day. Devotees, Prabhupada said, fasting is feasting, and feasting is fasting. So, in other words, everyone likes feasting, but what makes feasting nice is fasting. So fasting, we fast in honor of Lord Balarama, which is tomorrow in the morning. It's a half a day fast. And for the devotees here, we'll prepare a nice feast for everyone at lunchtime, right? And is there in the evening too? There's a feast in the evening and at lunch? Two feasts. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, Boston, keep going.
We've
got a good temple president who knows how to feed the devotees. So that's tomorrow. Tomorrow at 8 o'clock we'll begin another class on the appearance of Lord Balarama in this world. And then tomorrow night we'll speak again about some of Lord Balarama's transcendental pastimes. So we'll stop here. Any questions or comments before we end on Lord Balarama? Oh, yes. Okay.
Hare
Krishna. Well, he's representing Balarama, so he's carrying the mercy of Balarama. The relationship between the disciple and the spiritual master is the relationship of service to the spiritual master. So our relationship between us and the Lord is also of service. So when we're serving the spiritual master, he's taking that service and offering it to Lord Balarama. So you're actually serving Lord Balarama through the spiritual master. We can't approach the Lord directly. So being the representative of the mercy of Lord Balarama, he's accepting our service and offering that service to Lord Balarama. And that way we get Balarama's mercy. Like that. So the spiritual master is not the body. He is the principle of devotion to the Lord. I mean, if you see the spiritual master as being a particular body, or coming from a particular background, then you're seeing material. Spiritual master is empowered by the Lord to represent the Lord by giving the Lord's mercy in the form of guidance and philosophical instructions. When we accept these two things and apply it in our life and serve, and we connect with the spiritual master who connects us with the Lord. So it's direct and indirect at the same time. But it's direct through the spiritual master. Is that good? Yeah, the spiritual master is not the boss. He's the principle of spirit devotion to the Lord. Kamalati was serving Srila Prabhupada. Back in 1967-68, she was Prabhupada's personal cook, and she really was attached to serving Prabhupada. At one point, Prabhupada was separated from her, and she had to stay back, and Prabhupada was going somewhere else. At one point, she was feeling separation from Prabhupada, and she wrote Prabhupada a letter explaining how she was missing his association. Prabhupada acknowledged her the feelings, and he complimented. But he also added one point. He said, but you should know that the spiritual master is not the body. He is the principle of devotion to the Lord. So if you're serving then you are connected with the spiritual master through the principle of service. Although physical presence is not there, still, on the spiritual path, when we're serving the spiritual master, even if he's not personally present, we're connected with the spiritual master. If we're in the presence of the spiritual master and we're not in the mood of service, we're not in this association. Association comes by service and by following the instructions. Okay? Make sense? Okay. You sure? I'm not sure you're sure.
It's impossible to understand Guru Tattva.
Yeah, I think I made it a little simple to understand. Guru Tattva is quite complex.
Yeah,
but the basic principle of our relationship with the Guru is three things. Pratipatena, Parikrasyena, and Sevaya. Krishna makes that point in the Bhagavad-gita. Pratipatena, Parikrasyena, Sevaya. Upadekshyanti te jnana yaminam prachadarshinaham. Humility, inquiry, and service. These are the three aspects of the relationship between the Guru and the disciple. Humility, an eagerness to know, and an eagerness to serve. If those things are not there, the relationship with the spiritual master hasn't really developed. It's just taking initiation doesn't mean you're connected to the spiritual master. It's an active principle of service and inquiry. That's where the relationship actually develops. Because the spiritual master is coming on behalf of the Lord, and he's accepting service on behalf of the Lord, and he offers that service to the Lord. So there's your connection with Krishna through serving the spiritual master. He's transparent by an idea. You're not serving the spiritual master and it stops there. He offers that to Krishna. If he doesn't offer to Krishna, then he is not qualified to perform that service. It's on behalf of the Lord. Is that correct?
Yeah. Just that makes it kind of impersonal, so instead of our spiritual master, it could be any spiritual master, any person.
Where is the impersonal part?
That
we develop relationship with our specific guru. Yeah. Right? So if some person has
Guru
Shiva
Prabhupada, specifically
attached
to him, rather
than
different
guru. No, Prabhupada, in the case of Prabhupada, Prabhupada is everyone's guru. He's the founder of Charis, he's the Shiksha Guru for all devotees, all for all times. Anyone who comes in this movement has a direct, not indirect, relationship with Prabhupada. He's the Shiksha Guru for everyone. But some have him as Diksha Guru. And Shiksha and Diksha, according to Shastra, are two manifestations of the Absolute Truth, and they're non-different. So, but even if you take in shelter of one of Prabhupada's disciples who's a spiritual master. His godbrother, who also is a spiritual master, you should see him as a guru also. You may not have the same relationship, but you treat him in the same way. You treat your guru's godbrother as you treat your guru. That's the etiquette. It's a spiritual movement. It's not having the body. We have bodies. Everybody has a body. But we have to go beyond the body to understand what is our relationship with that person who performs the service in the spiritual ministry. It's not material. So my goal. himself in different forms of himself to render service to himself by giving mercy for the conditioned souls. Guru mm-hmm. is one. Mm-hmm. But he is manifested in different forms as well. Okay, we'll go on later. Guru Tattva is a little difficult to understand. But if you understand the principle of what is your relationship, then you can understand everything after that. It's all about service. If you're not serving, you don't have a relationship. If you're not following the instructions, you don't have a relationship. Guru is not there to collect disciples or to make money or to get presents on his birthday. That's not his program. His program is to uplift the conditions of us. That's his only program. Any other questions? Yes.
So what are the differences between Krishna and Balarama? When Krishna plays the flute and Balarama plays the horn.
Balarama also plays the flute.
He also plays the flute?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm reading a verse.
But my question is, what's the significance of the horn?
What's the difference between Krishna and Balarama? What's the difference between the two?
No, the horn. What's the significance of the horn?
Krishna plays the horn, they both play the horn. Yeah. Here, I'll give you a reading verse. This is from 10th Canto. The cowherd girl said, "O friends, those eyes that see the beautiful faces of the sons of Nanda are certainly fortunate. As these two sons enter the forest, surrounded by their friends, driving the cows before them, they hold their flutes to their mouth and glance lovingly upon the residents of Vrindavan. For those who have eyes, we think there is no greater object of vision." So Krishna and Balarama both play flutes. This verse, I picked this verse because we have a doubt about whether Balarama plays the flute. He does. He plays the flute. There's another verse also that mentions that. But he has a cowherd boys, they have flutes, they have horns, and what else they have? They have sticks, they carry sticks. Okay. Mm-hmm. So they have their,
What is the chapter you said?
The verse?
Yeah.
It's 10th Canto, 21st chapter, verse number 7. And if you go to Nandagram in Vrindavan, you'll see Krishna and Balarama on the altar both holding flutes. Mm-hmm. One man came and he criticized the pujaris there. He said, "What is this Balarama playing the flute?" So the pujari pulled out this verse. That was the end of that. So he plays flute too. He likes to play flute. But we don't usually give him a flute. We usually give him he has his club and plow. Okay. Anything else? Yes.
Thank you, Shamala. You mentioned that when you were listing the paraphernalia of the Lord, that is Balaram, you mentioned that the Lord's jewelry is...
Jewelry is also not all the jewelry.
Yes, you mentioned not all the jewelry is going around. So is there another personality?
No, some jewelry is not in the paraphernalia of the Lord. Jewelry has different qualities. So sometimes fake jewelry is not.
Okay.
But we use fake jewelry because people will steal the real stuff. Yes, that's why we use cosmetic, or what they say,
costume jewelry,
because there's been examples where people who are on the altar steal the jewelry, so it's happened. So therefore, even the pujaris do that. It's happened a few times. So therefore, we use custom jewelry. So, but It's only the real jewelry that is the manifestation of Balarama, the real, you know, precious man like that. Yeah. I saw another hand. Yes, name was Manjari. Thank you for coming.
Maharaj, I was thinking when you were explaining about how Balaram destroys two anarthas and Krishna destroys the others, but I cannot comprehend, because usually we try to destroy the anarthas with our efforts, but it's only by Krishna's mercy that ultimately we can overcome them. So what is the subtle difference between Balaram's killing the demons and Krishna killing some demons?
Well, it's mentioned that we have Purabdha Karma. Purabdha Karma is that karma that's manifesting right now. So that Purabdha Karma is the reactions of your past activities in the material world. So you have to recognize it, and you have to overcome it by your own endeavor. And that is by the mercy of the spiritual master. You take his mercy and then you apply the instructions and you overcome these anarthas. In the case of Krishna, a lot of times he destroys the anartha directly by killing the demon within our heart through the process of devotional service. So this is mentioned by Bhaktivinoda Thakur in Chaitanya Shikshamrita. He explains that these two demons mean that we have to make an effort by the mercy of Lord Balaram coming through our spiritual master to overcome these anarthas. That's why you see devotees fall prey to these two things. You know, illicit activities of the opposite sex and what is it? Just collecting useless information or working hard for material gain. And so these things we have to overcome by our own efforts. But that effort is coming, the help is coming by the mercy of the Guru. As opposed to the other demons, Krishna kills directly by the power of our own bhakti. That's how it's explained. You see the difference? So you have to make an effort on these two efforts, these two anarthas. Anything else? I saw another hand. Yes.
Is it very simplistic if I say that Nityanand Prabhu is more merciful than Balaram? Is there any comparison to be made? Like the story you gave about Baldev, you know, strangling some boy.
It's what you're saying is true, but it needs some qualifications. And what is that qualification is that Balaram and Nittai is the same. Rajendra Nandana Ye, Sachi Sunta Hoylo Say, Balaram Hoylo Nittai. There's no difference between Krishna and Balaram, Krishna and Lord Chaitanya, and no difference between Balaram and Nityananda. But Lord Nityananda is manifesting more of the mercy of the Absolute Truth in his relationship to the conditioned souls. But Balaram just kind of killed him. But Nityananda, he could have killed Jagaya Mani, but he didn't. He simply took their harassment and gave them love of God. Paramananda, what is that? Akroda Paramananda Nityananda. He is the manifestation of extreme mercy of Lord Balarama, who's come in the form as Lord Nityananda. Two persons, same person, two forms, mercy manifests differently. That's all. Balarama could have manifested that mercy in Krishna Lila, but he didn't. But when Gaur came, then he performed, he gave that mercy. Because in Kali Yuga, everyone needs a lot of mercy. So that's why Lord Nityananda is. He's extreme manifestation of mercy in this age. And it's also power. See the connection?
No.
Okay, any anything else before we end? I think there's prasadam for all the devotees. Another question, yes.
So is there, wherever glorification of Lord, like Srimad Bhagavatam and all these teachings of Lord, so is that, like wherever glorification, so that is also, you know, due to Balaram, we can say?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's arranging for the Lord to become glorified in different ways. You can say Srimad Bhagavatam is an expansion of Lord Balaram also. All the ways that the Supreme Lord is served in different manifestations are all expansions or extensions of Lord Balarama. Mm-hmm. He serves in so many ways. And he manifests himself as the spiritual master to serve in this material world through bringing the conditioned souls back to Krishna. Okay, so I think there's some prasadam for everyone. Yes? Okay, thank you very much. So if you're able to come tomorrow, even if you're not able to come, come anyway. For some more Balaram Kita, and tomorrow's Balaram Superior Day. So thank you very much.
Thank you.